Seminole's defining challenge of our time. If we're honest people, for people who are in touch with reality, we know certainly those words are true. We are so very appreciative of the topic that we're dealing with on this week. We are very appreciative of all of the wisdom and the time and the effort that's going into looking at this particular topic. Do you understand the biblical view of the home? Here's a quotation that some of you might be familiar with. I lost almost 9,000 games. I missed more than 300 shots. 26 times, I've lost almost 9,000 games. I've missed more than 300 shots. 26 times I've been entrusted to take the game-winning shot and missed it. I failed over and over and over again in my life, and that's why I succeed. If you're a basketball fanatic, you probably recognize that as the words of Michael Jordan. And whenever you look at that particular book and you find those words, one thing Michael Jordan was striving to do is try to help us to understand that if we're going to be successful at a thing, then we first have to be willing to attempt that thing. And then he also wants to impress upon us that amid those attempts, failure is inevitable. Now, when we take a look at basketball, when we look at Michael Jordan, we understand that that's probably a noble sentiment. Something that we have to make sure we understand on tonight is this, and that is that raising children is not basketball. My friends, we simply do not get 9,000 attempts at getting it right. We need to ensure that we understand, again, the very critical nature of what it is that we're dealing with on tonight. The subject matter that is ahead of us on tonight is why some fathers fail. And by virtue of the fact that we can look at a topic called why some fathers fail, implies that sometimes fathers fail. And that is certainly the case. We understand that is the case when we begin to look at some of the statistics that represent the truthfulness of that particular matter. We want to look at some failure facts real quickly before we get into the text of our lesson on tonight and before we get into some of the points that will comprise the lesson that we're looking at. We want to look at some failure facts. There are some who simply deny the fact that sometimes fathers fail. But again, we're not interested in what people think about this matter. We know that there are those who have an agenda sometimes that they want to promote, and that the promotion of that agenda will cause them to deny some of the plain facts of the matter. But the facts are thus, whenever we begin to look at them, approximately 17,000 teenage deaths occur annually in the United States of America. Of those 17,000 deaths, 50% are comprised of accidents, 73%. Involving motor vehicles. Not only that, but 13% are due to homicides, predominantly from gang violence. We find that 11% result from suicides. 1 in 16 high school seniors, according to the National Institute on Drug Abuse, participate in daily marijuana use. Not only that, but when we continue looking at failure facts, we understand that where teenage alcoholism in the United States of America is concerned, realize that in 2010, approximately 189,000 emergency room visits took place by persons under the age of 21 for injuries and other conditions that were related to alcoholism. 189,000 emergency room visits by minors in regards to alcoholism. Annually, more than 4,300 deaths occur among youths due to excessive drinking. You can find these statistics on the CDC website. Not only that, when we begin to talk about young people and sexual behavior, on the CDC website as well, and it's very interesting to me, if you know anything about the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, this is one of the most liberal organizations that there is out there, but yet still, they give you the facts of the matter in regards to some of the very things they promote. They are some of the biggest and strongest proponents of youth being involved in sexual behavior, but yet still, very interestingly, they'll tell you some of the things that go on in regards to sexual risk behavior where young people are concerned. 48% of high school students surveyed in a 2013 study had engaged in sexual intercourse. 15% had had sex, according to this study, with four or more people in their lifetime. 8,300 people between the age 13 and 24, in the 40 states that report to the CDC have HIV infection in 2009. Nearly half of the 19 million newly transmitted sexual diseases that occur in the United States of America each year involve children between the ages of 15 and 24. And here's a statistic that might be interesting to you because we'll see this a little bit later. 400,000 teen girls gave birth between the ages of 16 and 19 in 2009. I'll show you why that becomes increasingly interesting to us. The Guttmacher Institute fact sheet tells us that by age 19, 70% of youth have had sexual intercourse, and annually, 615,000 girls aged 15 to 19 report pregnancy. Now remember what we said a moment ago, a little more than 4,000 gave birth in 2010. But in 2009, 615,000 reported pregnancy. Well, you do the math, you might scratch your head a little bit. What happens to all of these other pregnancies? Well, you find out that 157,000 reported abortions occurred in 2010 by girls between the ages of 15 and 19. And so we understand that there is a problem among our children. We understand that there is some failure where fatherhood is concerned. We look at those statistics, and those statistics are the ones that are heart-wrenching, to say the very least. But what they are indicative of generally is fatherhood failure. Now, before we get into, again, the points of the lesson, I want to make a couple of disclaimers. And some of these disclaimers have been mentioned in some of the other sermons. Certainly, we're not suggesting tonight that every time a child turns out with problems, that the father has failed miserably where that's concerned. I think what Brother Brian mentioned on yesterday, that even when we begin looking at these children, we have to understand that God gives them their own brains, gives them their own minds. Sometimes their fathers have done the things that God requires that we do. Some of the things Brother Corey has just mentioned, well, kids are still sometimes going to do whatever it is that they choose to do. So we're not suggesting tonight that every time a child fails, that a father has failed. But we certainly want to say this, that generally, whenever a child is turned out with problems, some of the problems that we've seen already, it generally is the case that a father can be looked at. And generally it's the case there's some deficiencies where that fatherhood is concerned. And so we want to make that very clear on tonight. We talk about failure among fathers. And there are three things that I want to look at in particular on tonight. Certainly the time and space will fail us to talk about all of the possible reasons that sometimes we as fathers drop the ball verbally speaking, that we fail. But I want to look at three tonight that I think will resonate with us. And the first of those is number one, sometimes fathers fail because they're simply not there. Because they're simply not there. We understand that there's a problem of monumental proportions that is going on in the country in which you and I live. That's one of the sub-points that we'll look at tonight. And then we'll look at number two, that there's a prototype that we need to be giving some attendance to. So when we talk about sometimes fathers failing because they are not there, we realize that this is a problem. Now again, as we mentioned a moment ago, there are some who simply would deny that this is even a problem. There are some who will believe that, well, you know, sometimes homes by design don't have a father in them, and that's perfectly okay. But we want to see if that's really the case on tonight. We want to look at the idea that the problem sometimes occurs because of these reasons. Number one, because of cohabitation. Because of cohabitation. Now, last night, a good brother talked about the book of 1 Peter chapter 3, verse number 7, and he mentioned the fact that there is a term that is utilized in that particular verse, a term that is translated in the King James Version, dwell together. And that term might also be rendered cohabitate. So the Bible talks about us as fathers, as husbands rather, dwelling together with our wives according to knowledge. And one thing that our brother pointed out last night is that God is speaking to husbands and wives. Amen. So husbands and wives are to dwell with one another according to knowledge. My friends, no one else has authorization where a romantic relationship is concerned to dwell together, except those who are dwelling together in a lawful marriage. And so that's certainly one of the problems that we'll take a look at. We'll get some statistics in just a moment that speak to us regarding regards to that particular problem. We also want to look at the culture of casual sex in our country. In the 1960s, you had a movement of rebellion, and one of the features of that movement was something that they like to call free love. And of course, maybe a more accurate term would be free lust, and that was an extension of the postmodernistic ideology that teaches that there really is no objective truth, there really are no objective morals, that there is really no absolute standard that we have to live by. We really are free simply to do what it is that we want to do. And of course, we're able to sleep freely with whoever we want to sleep with. We'll take a look at that as well, just for just a moment. And then we'll also take a look at some of the consequences as we make the point here that fathers not being there is a problem that we have to deal with in our particular society. First of all, the idea of cohabitation. You find out whenever you visit the CDC website that 57% of all romantic heterosexual couples are simply cohabitating rather than choosing to marry. Now, back in the day, our parents called it shacking up. And it's probably a more accurate term for that, because again, when we look at terminology, cohabitation or dwelling together, God used that term to refer to something that married people should be doing. And so 57% of all romantic couples, heterosexual couples, are simply shacking up rather than choosing to marry. My friend, that's a problem. There are some who would have to believe that, again, this is the beneficial way to experiment with romance. But when we look at the truth of the matter, we're going to find out that the facts teach us something a lot different than that. Again, the culture of casual sex, which on last night, our brother again asked the question, has anybody been familiar with the term friends with benefits? And we've all heard the terminology and we understand what it means. That is a term that refers to the idea that people are engaging in casual sex today. Don't have to be married according to, again, the ideology among us today. But you simply exercise the freedom to have sex with whoever you choose to. Well, here's the results of those particular sentiments. 40% of all American children are born outside of wedlock. I want you to think about that again. 40%, nearly one half of all American children are born outside of wedlock. And again, what that translates into is this: homes where there is no father present. Because a lot of times what happens is you will have these cohabitation situations going on, and a man will be there. And of course, he will contribute to the conception of a child, but as studies show, most of these cohabitation circumstances, they end up with these two people going their separate ways. They like to try to make you believe these people are just simply testing the waters ahead of time, and then they will get married eventually, but show that's simply not the case. Most of these cohabitating couples, they will go their separate ways. But once they introduce children into that equation, this is typically what happens. The man is the one who goes a separate way. Leaves a woman there with children, a child or children, with no father present. And again, the question that needs to be asked is this: when fathers become absentee parents, is the result a perfectly healthy and suitable alternative style home? Because you've heard that, haven't you? That's simply an alternative style home, and that's perfectly fine, and the children are perfectly healthy in that particular situation. But again, I want to suggest to you tonight that the truth of the matter that begs to differ. Whenever we examine the facts of this situation, we find something very different than that. There is an organization referred to as the National Center for Fathering. And on their website, they contain an information page entitled The Extent of Fatherlessness. If you ever go visit that website, one of the first things that you'll see is an affirmation they make right out off the bat, and that is that more than 20 million children lay their heads down at night in homes where there is no father physically present. They also go on to say that if it were classified as a disease, fatherlessness would be an epidemic worthy of attention as a national emergency. Fathers.com. The site also contains a video clip of a documentary film by the organization Focus on the Family. Some of you may have heard that organization, Focus on the Family. And so they've got a documentary that they call they call Irreplaceable. And there's a video clip of that documentary on this particular website, fathers.com. And whenever you begin to watch the clip, you'll find out that there's a voice of a narrator in a very somber tone. He begins to enumerate some of the problems that result as a result of fathers not being there. Here are some of those problems. 71% of high school dropouts come from fatherless homes. Fatherless homes are responsible for 71% of teen pregnancies. Fatherless homes are responsible for 85% of the children who have behavioral problems. 90% of homeless or runaway children come from fatherless homes. 63% of youth suicides come out of homes where there is no father. And then finally, 85% of all youth in prison come from homes where the father was simply not there. I read when we talk about fatherhood failure, the first thing we need to be able to address is the idea that sometimes fathers simply are not there. And that becomes a problem. Now, I'm going to date myself when I mention this, but between 1988 and 1998, there was a sitcom that came out called Murphy Brown. It ran for 247 seasons. Some of you, the older people in here, will remember Murphy Brown. And when you look at that show, it portrayed the father as an expendable and unnecessary part of the parental partnership. But here's something I want you to consider tonight. Does the Heavenly Father consider the father in the home an indispensable, or a dispensable rather, an unnecessary part of the paternal or the parental partnership? Well, I invite you to go back to the prototype. If you have your Bibles this evening, I invite you to go back to the book of Genesis. As we talk about the fact that sometimes fathers fail because they're simply not there, we realize that this is a problem. And again, the facts of the matter bear this out. But not only that, there's a prototype. So this is a problem that simply does not have to exist, because God has given us a pattern, if you will, a prototype, if you will. As you turn over to the book of Genesis, I want you to be mindful of Matthew chapter 19. Whenever I think about this point, Matthew 19 comes to mind. This is the place where the Pharisees and the scribes had come to Christ. And they have a question for him concerning marriage. And the question that they pose him in verse number 3 is this: is it okay for us to put away our wives for every cause? And of course, Christ answered that question by taking them back to the beginning. He takes them back to the beginning. And why does he take them back to the beginning? Because what he wants to do is amend human thinking in regards to the horrible frequency of marital failure. And what we suggest to you tonight is this, is that if we want to amend the horrible frequency of paternal failure, then we need to employ the exact same tactic. We need to go back to the beginning. We need to see the prototype. We need to see how it is that God created this situation. And so in Genesis chapter 1, we're familiar with verse number 27. On the sixth day of the creative week, the Bible says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. I want to reemphasize that God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. One time in my life when I was younger, I overheard a woman speaking in jest to her husband about one of their co-workers. And here's what she said in regards to his co-worker. His co-worker was a woman who had had 6 children without the benefit of ever marrying. So she had 6 children out of wedlock. And I heard the woman tell her husband in regards to this co-worker of theirs, this woman is taking very seriously God's commandment to be fruitful and to multiply. I would suggest to you tonight that she hasn't taken serious God's commandment to be fruitful and multiply, because God gave that commandment to a married couple. He gave that commandment to a married couple. He didn't give it to a single woman, but he gave it to a married couple. And I understand, again, that whenever we look at that illustration, it explicitly mentions the irresponsible woman, but it's equally the irresponsible man. This is the focus of our study on tonight. My friends, an absolute monumental contributor to the failure of fathers today is the fact that so many of them simply are not there. And here's something that we want to be aware of as well tonight. My friends, whenever fathers fail in this regard, not only do they fail their children, but they fail women. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 15, Bible teaches us that the rod and correction bring wisdom, or rod and reproof bring wisdom, but a child left to himself brings his mother to shame. And so as fathers are failing by not being there, not only are they failing the children, they're failing their mothers, a child left to himself again brings his mother to shame. Whenever fathers fail, society is failed. I remember someone mentioning that on last night. And not only that, when fathers fail, we fail ourselves. And above all, whenever fathers fail, we fail the God of heaven. Because he has the way, this infinite wisdom in which this thing ought to transpire. And again, we see it when we look at the prototypical family. God created Adam. Of course, whenever we go to chapter 2, we see the details of him creating woman. And it's always very interesting to point out that God did not create Adam a girlfriend. He didn't create Adam someone to simply cohabitate with. He didn't create Adam a fiance, but he created Adam a wife. Amen. Of course, we're familiar with the text. The Bible lets us know, beginning there in verse 21, the Lord God calls a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And God took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh and sin thereof. And the rib which the Lord God taketh from man made he a woman. And he brought her unto the man. And the man said, now this is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, she should be called a woman, because she was taken out of man. Now notice verse 24, what he goes on to say. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother, and cleave unto his girlfriend. Leave his father and mother and cleave unto his living. Leave his father and mother, cleave unto his fiance. He says he should leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife. And so we look at Adam, and Adam, whenever he was created, he was a man. Whenever Eve was created, not only was she a woman, she was a wife. She never had been anything other than a wife. God created Adam a wife. We look at a second issue in regards to why some fathers fail. And that second issue is this. Sometimes we are simply not aware. Not there, number one. Number two, not aware. What are we talking about when we say sometimes fathers are simply not aware? Well, I think there are two things that we need to consider. In particular, number one, an ignorance of what the Bible teaches concerning fatherhood and the spiritual needs of children. Sometimes fathers are unaware of that. And then number two, sometimes fathers are simply unaware of what is going on in the lives of our children. My friends, we suggest tonight that both of these things are detrimental. And the reason is that sometimes fathers fail. Number one, looking at the idea of fathers not being aware of what the Bible teaches concerning fatherhood. Friends, when we look at the text of God, one of the things that God deals with at the very outset of the writing of his holy book and dealing with humanity concerning fatherhood is that we ought to be teaching our children. Is that true? We ought to be teaching them. You look at places like the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. And what does the Bible teach us? What we ought to be teaching our children. This is what is often referred to as the Shema Israel. And, of course, Moses is writing here, and he says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And these words which I command you this day, they should be in your heart. And not only that, he tells the children of Israel that you should teach them diligently unto your children. You ought to talk to them whenever you sit down in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. I'm convinced today that so many instances of failure occur among fathers because we simply do not take these verses seriously. Amen. I heard Brother Brad Harrow in a lecture he did one time called Consequences. Maybe some of you heard that. He put it out on DVD. But he gave a statistic one time that I thought was absolutely mind-boggling. He says, and he's talking about in the Lord's church, that for every four adults, we're only getting one child faithfully into adulthood. Now I thought about that. And I think about it along these terms. For every four adults, we're only getting one child faithfully into adulthood. Let's take those four adults, and let's say they are two couples. And in the United States of America, every couple has on average three children. And so if you take four people, two couples, how many children do you have on average? Six. And out of six children, we're only getting one faithfully into adulthood. My friends, that is absolutely despicable. It's despicable. What is going on? Well, I think what's going on is, at least in part, us not being aware of what the Bible teaches concerning fatherhood, what our responsibilities are, and what the spiritual need of our children are. Again, we look at places like Ezra 7, verse number 10. The Bible talks about Ezra, of course, whenever he's coming back into Judea after the 70 years of Babylonian captivity, and he's responsible for a portion of the restoration of Israel. The Bible lets us know that Ezra prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it, and to teach in Israel statutes and judgments. And so, as fathers, we need to be like Ezra. We need to first educate ourselves in what the Word of God has to say to us as human beings, and then we need to be willing to teach those things diligently to others who need those things taught them. I was in the gymnasium working out one day, and as people are prone to doing it today, sometimes we sit around and talk a little bit in between sets. I was talking with a guy and a woman, and they weren't together. It's just three different people there talking, and she was pregnant with her and her husband's first child. And so we began to talk about her pregnancy, and as we did that, one of the things that the man who was sitting there with us said was this: too bad babies don't come with an instruction booklet. My friend, the fact of the matter is they do. That instruction booklet is called the Bible. You look at the book of 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 3, and the Bible says, God has given unto us all things to thank the light and godliness through the knowledge of Him who has called us to glory and worship. God has given us all things to pertain to life and godliness, and that includes parenting our children. And it's without a doubt that statements like that and sentiments like that are the reason that so many fathers are failing today. In the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 16, and probably most of us can quote this, Paul says that all scripture is given by the inspiration of God and profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect and truly furnished unto every good work. And so sometimes fathers fail. Number one, because we're simply not there. Sometimes we fail. Number two, because we are not aware. Not aware of what the Bible teaches concerning fatherhood. And number two, not aware of what the Bible teaches concerning discipline. We look at the development of children, and of course they are to be instructed from God's book, but we also look at the idea of discipline. And sometimes discipline is something that has become very infrequent in Christian homes. Sometimes we have bought into the ideologies of the world around us, and we have not disciplined our children the way that the Bible teaches us to. I want you to think about something tonight. I want you to think about the blight and the irritating repetition of undisciplined children in our world today. How many of you have perhaps been in a grocery store, perhaps at the movies or somewhere, only to have children that are running around like banshees seemingly? Undisciplined. Sometimes you can't speak to them and they won't speak back to you. I remember being at a hotel. My wife and I were traveling somewhere on a speaking engagement, and we went down for breakfast one morning, and there was obviously a basketball team of high school kids that were there getting breakfast as well. And I was sitting at the, I think at the cereal bin or something like that. And there was a young man sitting there beside me about as tall as I was. And so I was just striking a casual conversation that morning. Hey, man, how you guys doing? Are you guys here on a basketball trip? And that's the response I got. Absolutely nothing. I wasn't even there. And I think about things like that. I know if I had done that when I was a child, my mother probably would have stopped my teeth down. If I had done